To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power before all time, now, and forevermore. Amen. It's one of my favorite doxologies, Jude verses 24 and 25. It's good for us to be together, to be gathered in the presence of our Lord and with one another to glorify Him, to edify each other. We're glad that you are a part of our assembly this morning. Once again, a warm welcome to those who are visiting with us. We're always glad when visitors come our way, and we hope being here will bless you and that we can be a blessing to you in helping you to know God and know His will for your life, His plan for your salvation. Our condolences, of course, to Jerry and Sherry in the passing of their son, JT. And we pray God's grace would be upon you. I don't know if they're able to be watching right now. They went to Florida to be with him. And we certainly pray that God's hand would be upon you, our dear brother and sister, and on JT's family. And, of course, also to Carissa and her family in the passing of her daddy. And it is a joy to know that he was a godly man, a preacher of the gospel, whom the Lord used to touch many lives that way. And as Robert was saying, as he led us in prayer and left a legacy of faithfulness. And so even though there's sorrow when we lose a loved one, when we lose a loved one in the Lord, We do not sorrow, as Paul said, as those who have no hope. And we were talking about that hope as we looked at Romans 8 in class and the hope of glory and what that involves. These are exciting things. These are thrilling things. We live in a fallen world, a world of groaning, Paul says, where we're longing for what's beyond this world. And sometimes when hardship and devastation comes our way, it intensifies that groaning and that longing. We've been through experiences in our own lives and collectively as a congregation, as a community. In fact, not long ago, facing what some are about to face right now in the Gulf Coast. And we're thankful we're spared this time, but surely we can understand what people are going to be dealing with. Those of you who lived here during the storms like we had with Harvey, we were in the Mississippi Gulf Coast when Katrina hit there. As they said in those parts, Hurricane Katrina hit the Mississippi Gulf Coast when we were living there. So certainly I'm glad we could be together to pray about those things and to focus our hearts and our minds on a time when we can go beyond this period of groaning into the period of glory. We praise God that it can be so. I don't know if you've heard of R.G. Ingersoll. He was a famed orator from the 19th century. He was one of the most famous lecturers in all the country. And in fact, he was an infamous agnostic, really an atheist, an outspoken critic of the Bible who would pour out his venom on Christianity and on the scriptures. And he would do that to large audiences who would travel for miles and gather to hear him speak. He was that eloquent of an orator and had that big of an influence. They've marked the place where he was born in Dresden, New York. Although he did not live there long, he spent most of his life in Illinois. And in fact, he was a Civil War veteran. And in Peoria, I believe, is where this statue is of R.G. Ingersoll. And so he's kind of a champion, so to speak, of atheists today who look to him and look to his writings with great admiration. And as I said, he liked to pour out his venom. He was vociferous in and the vitriol that he had for the Christian system and the doctrines of Scripture, and especially what the Bible says about hell. And here we have some of Ingersoll's thoughts that he expressed in his lectures about the biblical teaching on hell. He said, "If there is a God who will damn his children forever, I would rather go to hell than to go to heaven and keep the society of such an infamous tyrant. I despise that doctrine, the doctrine of hell. It has covered the cheeks of this world with tears. It has polluted the hearts of children and poisoned the imaginations of men." Now, he's talking here about when he first was terrified when he heard a powerful sermon on hell, and he was actually raised by a preacher. But he says, "For the first time in my life, my imagination grasped the height and depth of the Christian horror. And then I said, it is a lie. And I hate you. I hate your religion," that should say. "And if it's true, I hate your God." Now, those are some very strong words. I don't know how we could put the objection to the biblical teaching on hell in any stronger terms than that. But because so many find the Bible's teaching on this subject odious, including those who profess the Christian religion, it's important for us to think about some of the things we're going to look at this morning in this lesson. In our series now, Heaven, Hell, and the Christian Hope. And if you've been here for the series, you know we started by focusing on the coming judgment. There's a great day coming. And in the day of judgment, I just want to reiterate this again, that we know that God is just and that God made us as free moral agents who can choose to do right or refuse to do right. And because we are capable of moral choice, therefore God holds us accountable for what we've done. And so that is a tremendously important motivation when it comes to the way that we live, to think that everything we say, everything we do, every step you take, every move you make, remember I was quoting every cake you bake, but I wanted to add to those things we talked about, every text you send, every website you visit, every comment that you make on social media. See, everything that we have said and done and thought, all of that will face us in the judgment. And so that's why the choices we make in this life matter. They matter for eternity. This is of tremendous importance. The whole biblical worldview of human accountability, of our nature, God's nature, and the fact that there are real consequences to the choices that we make in this life. And the way we put it was that right now counts for forever. So those are some very sobering matters. Now, if my record is not cleared of the things I've done that are sinful, if my sin is not forgiven and if I'm not put right with God, then I will be lost forever. I will be in a condition that the Bible describes as hell. That's what we started to address in the last lesson, last Lord's Day morning, and that was the title, the one word, those four letters, hell. But the subtitle we said is very important, eternity without God. So we're continuing that lesson now. You can write that down again if you're starting a new page in your notes, or you can pull up that same place where you were taking notes and continue from there. And I apologize, I'm going to have to turn off the mic and do this again. Excuse me. Okay, I think that'll do it. Thank you. And we said, really, there are two basic questions. To me, this makes the most sense. How should we approach this subject? What the Word of God tells us about the state of the damned, if you will, or the state of the soul that is lost. Well, we can ask, what's it going to be like and who's going to be there? So we already started that, but we said in between here, we think that it's important to address the whole idea about hell and the goodness of God and whether it can be reconciled with a just and loving God because of the objections that we often hear from outside and within the, quote, Christian community. It's important to look at this. So we already talked about what it's going to be like, and we went through what I think are metaphors that describe the suffering of hell to be separated from God for eternity. But the question now that concerns us, is it just for God to consign people to eternal suffering? Another way to state this point is to ask, is hell compatible with an all-good, an all-loving, and a just God? And I have a little footnote there for hell. And what we mean by hell here is what we set forth in the last lesson. We mean the conscious suffering of the lost for all eternity, the traditional, that would be called the traditional view of the church, the traditional view in Christian history of the Bible's teaching on hell. Because some people will define that word in a different way to signify something, I think, contrary to what the Bible says. They'll define it in a way that suggests it just means ceasing to exist. We'll look at that here in just a moment. But we mean for people to be conscious and to actively experience suffering forever and ever, how can that be reconciled with a God who is all-loving, who is all-good? So let's look at some of the objections that arise. And I wanted to categorize some of the thoughts that we hear, some of the objections that we hear on this subject. It's argued that tormenting people forever is monstrous. Some would even describe hell as an eternal Auschwitz that would make God even worse than Hitler. We hear that kind of very passionate objection because I think often people have this imagery of hell as this kind of active torturing of people for all of eternity. That's why we pointed out in the lesson last week, we shouldn't think of hell in terms of the disturbing medieval imagery, the horrific imagery that you often see in medieval artwork that was too disturbing even to show some examples of. You know, I like to show classical artwork when we're looking at biblical subjects, but I couldn't really find any that would be suitable for a setting like this. They're so macabre, they're so dark and distorted, and that isn't the way in which we should understand what the Bible's telling us about the suffering of the lost in hell. That's why we think that's a very important point to make. As I said, I believe the biblical imagery of hell, the lake of fire, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth, where their worm dies not and the fire is not quenched. Yes, those are frightening images. But I think they're metaphors intended to convey the magnitude of what it is to be separated from God, the source of all that is good and right, the one for whom we were made. Now, when we say then these are metaphors, that does not minimize that suffering. We're not trying to just explain it away and say, oh, well, really, hell's not going to be that bad. Tyler just said those are just figures of speech. Tyler just said, you know, they're just metaphors, and so I don't really have to worry about hell being all that bad. No, no, no. Of course, that's not what I'm saying. But I don't think we should think of hell as demons with firebrands and holding people over pots of molten oil and you know, torturing them like you often see in those kinds of images. And I can understand why if people have that misconception of hell, that they would find that sort of thing monstrous. But that still doesn't settle the whole matter, of course. But what we pointed out is the emphasis is on the suffering of the soul because of separation from God. That's the emphasis, to be sent away from God and from the glory of His might. Depart from me. To be banished, to be away from fellowship with the God of love who made us to find our real self and true peace and true fulfillment in Him, to be separated from that forever. Well, the objection still comes along, though, or is still raised, that hell, nonetheless, it's incompatible with God's justice. And here, to take the objection to elaborate on it a bit, people might wonder, how can it be just to punish finite sins, sins that were committed in a temporal period, and punish them with infinite punishment that never ends, that just endures on and on and on forever and ever and ever? And see, it would be argued that even the most heinous things that anyone could ever do, even if he spent every moment of every hour of his entire life doing nothing but perpetrating the grossest kinds of evil, even that would be limited. How can God be just then to punish that with unlimited suffering that never ends? And you can see that in the minds of some people that creates a difficulty here, that the punishment isn't fitting the crime. And the way that some try to address that difficulty is advocating some kind of annihilationism, it's called. The idea that hell is where the lost are simply extinguished, where they cease to exist. They're just annihilated. They go out of being, go out of existence. And that is the view of a biblical scholar, Clark, known as Clark Pinnock. He's well known in biblical academia and biblical scholarly circles, was well known, his work was well known, and so he was a man of considerable influence. And the reason he advocated annihilationism, again, let me use his language, very strong terms here, where he says, let me say, as he addressed the subject, he said, let me say at the outset, I consider the concept of hell as endless torment in body and mind, and I'll outrageous doctrine. How can Christians possibly project a deity of such cruelty and vindictiveness, whose ways include inflicting everlasting torture upon his creatures, however sinful they may have been? And he goes on to say that surely a God who would do such a thing is more nearly like Satan than God. And so his solution to this was that God will simply annihilate those who are lost. They will not exist. That they might be punished for a certain period of time commensurate with the sins they committed in this life, but then they will simply be annihilated. And so death, the second death, means to no longer exist, and the fires of hell consume the lost so that they aren't actually consciously suffering for all eternity. But the problem is that might seem like an appealing solution to the issue. But we have to go to Scripture and see, does it fit with what we're told in the Word of God? Look at the passages we already introduced. I'm going to bring this verse before you a couple times here, where Jesus, in the judgment parables, in the great judgment scene, in the parable of the talents in Matthew 25, or when he talked about those who ministered to him and those who did not minister to him. And at the end of that, he said, these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. So just as long as the righteous enjoy eternal life, so we're told the lost will endure eternal punishment. Now, if that expression, we're told, from the Greek term, that means age long. And sometimes I'll say, well, it means just throughout that age where they're going to suffer, but it doesn't mean for all of eternity. But the point is, the same term is used for the duration of the blessedness of the saved in heaven. And so I don't see how that the annihilationist view can be made to fit with that and other passages as well that we've already introduced. It simply doesn't fit the biblical data. Now, Matthew 10:28, sometimes it's argued, well, Jesus said, don't fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. See, they'd say that's what hell is. It's not where you continue to suffer forever and ever, but it's where God destroys your soul. And so they would argue destroy. When you destroy something, it doesn't exist anymore. But that's not necessarily the import of that term. The context will have to determine how that word is being used. Destruction, often in biblical terms, means not loss of being, but loss of well-being. And a good example of that is in Revelation 17, 8 and 11, the beast and the false prophet were told that they were sent into destruction. But we find out in chapter 20 and verse 10 that their suffering continues. Their torment continues forever and ever. So destruction obviously didn't mean they did not exist anymore. But sometimes it's argued that destruction can mean that. It's argued that existence, in answer to this argument, that existence in hell may not be best understood in terms of the way that we think of time, where we endure something from one moment to the next, and the idea of then eternity, we would seem to take that and then extend that or project that to mean, what happens in hell, what happens in eternity, is those moments just continue to accumulate one after another without end. Whereas there may be another conception of time, whereas you simply exist in that state then, at the end of all things, at the end of time, and then we enter into eternity, it seems possible, and I know this is highly philosophical, and you get into concepts of time, and does God exist outside of time? These are difficult questions, but I think this can be helpful when we're trying to address these objections, that we don't necessarily understand how eternity works, and that C.S. Lewis actually argued that the fact that hell is forever is perhaps not so much that God is punishing the person forever, but that they're separated from God and that they exist forever, that the time, if you can even speak of hell in terms of time, is simply a feature of the fact that you will continue to exist. All right, if that didn't confuse you, then I'm not trying hard enough. I'll see what I can do as we proceed. Now, I think we should understand God will punish us if we die lost according to the works that we have done. And so our punishment will be commensurate to what we have done. It will fit the crime, and so there will be degrees of punishment. Not that anyone's going to be comfortable and happy in hell, but not everyone will suffer equally. We'll address that in another lesson about degrees of punishment and degrees of reward. That understood, we should realize that the issue of the suffering of the lost in hell, yes, they'll be punished for what they've done. The Bible makes that clear. We'll be judged by our works, and God will repay those passages I mentioned and many others. Will repay for what men have done. That's a source of great comfort when we want justice for ourselves, when we're wronged, that people will be held to account, and they will be held to pay. When we think of great atrocities done in the history of the world, we take comfort in that. But then, of course, it's a matter of concern when we start thinking about ourselves. But understand, though, that the lost are separated from God ultimately not so much for any particular sin that a person has committed, but for the ultimate sin of rejecting God. And that it's reasonable to think that people who die having rejected God continue to reject him forever. They maintain that same indifference, that same hostility toward God. And so as long as they maintain that spirit, so long then they remain separated from God. The way that I believe it was Jean-Paul Sartre put it, but I think Lewis also spoke of hell in these terms, that the door to hell is locked from the inside, and that those who suffer there choose to be there, and because they remain in a state of rejection to God, they ultimately choose to remain in hell. Not that they wouldn't like to be delivered from the suffering of hell, but they choose to remain in a state of rejection to God, and therefore punishment remains. Now some would say, though, hell is, if it's not incompatible with the justice of God, how can you reconcile it with what the Bible tells us about the love of God? And the way that some try to address this is by advocating some form of universalism. So on the one hand, some say the way we deal with how unpalatable the biblical teaching on hell seems to be, on the one hand, we can say, well, it's annihilation. But that doesn't fit what we find in Scripture, and we can provide answers to that objection. On the other hand, though, some would say, the answer is universalism, that no one really is going to be in hell, that in the end, everyone will end up being saved. And so if some are punished in hell, they would argue in this view that it would only be temporary and it would just be a time of purifying, as in the Catholic doctrine of purgatory. And as I mentioned, the Bible knows nothing of that idea of purgatory where we sort of do penance for sins and we're chastised for sins, even if we die saved with God, that we go through a period of chastisement and further sanctification before then we're fit to be in heaven. There's simply no biblical support for that idea. But this is the view some have, is that, well, the lost will be punished for a period of time, but in the end, everyone will finally be given an opportunity to respond to the love of God, and in the end, the love of God will win out and convert every soul so that everyone will be saved. And some would even argue that the devil himself and all the demons will be saved for all of eternity. That's the idea. Origen, all the way back to the 3rd century, advocated this view, and he was a great doctor, a great theologian, great thinker in the church, but he was condemned for this universalism that he espoused, and Gregory in after him in the 4th century. And there are those who advocate it in recent times. Rob Bell, I don't know if you've heard of Rob Bell, very well-known evangelical pastor of a mega church. He had a book that came out about a decade ago, and it caused quite a stir because of his wide influence. And he essentially argued that in the end, the love of God will end up winning out and converting every soul, even those who've already died lost. And in the end, he was advocating a kind of universalism, it seems, where everyone's going to end up saved. Now, more recently, this just came out a couple years ago, David Bentley Hart is a brilliant theologian and highly influential thinker, and he has come out in favor of universalism in his recent book, That All Shall Be Saved. And so we're finding this view finds a wider and wider acceptance in our day, the view of universalism. And there's even an entire church based on it, the Universalist Church. It was at one time the 6th largest denomination in the country, but its numbers began to wane, and they ended up combining with the Unitarian Church. And so the Universalist Church, they don't think anyone is going to be lost, hence the name. And they believe in universal salvation of everyone. And they essentially advocate anything and everything, it seems, except what the Word of God actually teaches. Mom, if you're watching, this is the Universalist Church in Buffalo. And the architecture is absolutely incredible there, but it's a shame that it's wasted on this false religion and all of the false teachings advocated by the Universalists, which are damning and destructive. But the Universalist Church, you see where this leads you. where they've essentially denied the deity of Christ, and they've ended up advocating all kinds of things contrary to Scripture because they've given up on anything that they find objectionable in Scripture. And so the Word of God then is utterly disregarded. Again, does universalism fit with what we find in Scripture? Didn't Jesus speak of some going away into punishment? A punishment without end. How can that be reconciled? See, what happens is if you advocate universalism or annihilationism, you begin to have to try to finesse and explain away all of these plain texts of Scripture, including all the ones that we introduced last time. Jesus talked about the fact that the way that leads to destruction will be taken by many. It's not just that the Bible doesn't teach everyone's going to be saved, but the Bible, in fact, teaches that most people will be lost. And people think, well, how can that be compatible with a God of love? Why would he create a world knowing that most people would reject him and be lost forever? I think the reason people hold that view, as we've already said, is they have a very selective view of God. They like to think of the love of God as an omnitolerance, that God approves of us and would never require anything of us that is contrary to what we want. So they have a very indulgent view of the love of God, and one that precludes any real meaningful sense of the holiness of God and the wrath of God. And then they have a very selective view of themselves. I think a big part of the problem is in our modern therapeutic age, where people think that they just need to get in touch with the real self within, and that's where real fulfillment is, because deep down inside I'm really a great person and I just need to tap into that and realize how wonderful I am. That whole therapeutic culture, it is a complete denial of what the Word of God tells us about our own sinfulness, our own corruption, and how heinous our sin is in the sight of a holy God. In fact, hell should show us that. What the Bible tells us about hell should show us the magnitude of our own sinfulness. Not that we're of no worth to God, but that our sin makes us worthy of punishment, worthy of judgment. And how would universalism fit with all the multitudes of warning, all the warnings we find in Scripture about God's coming wrath? If in the end, we're all going to go to heaven, if in the end, no one's going to be in hell, why be all that worried if you're just going to be extinguished and not exist anymore and not be held accountable in the way the Bible says for your actions? Well, why get all that concerned? Or if in the end, we're all going to be with God in a state of blessedness forever and ever, why be all that concerned? Why look at, I'm going to pass through this quickly here, this warning in Hebrews chapter 10, a very powerful passage, where God says, and here the writer in Hebrews is warning Christians. He's talking to the church, and he's warning us about not falling away from God, not denying the Lord. And he says, "For vengeance is mine." Yes, God of love is a God of vengeance. His justice, the demands of his justice must be satisfied. And so if my sin is not forgiven, the very fact that God holds me accountable for God proves that he's good. It's not contradicting the goodness of God, it's affirming the goodness of God. How can God be good and overlook sin? We're appalled at the judges who are giving light sentences or no sentences at all to violent criminals, releasing them without bond, and then they're going out and committing violence again, sometimes committing murder again, and people are outraged. That's not right. That's not fair. That's not just. People have to be held accountable for what they've done. Well, the same is true with my own sin. The same is true with God, because God is good, because God is just. But if in the end we're all going to be saved, how can you make any sense of a warning like Hebrews 10:31, that it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God? We should understand. Let's put the whole thing in perspective as we bring this to a close. God desires all men to be saved. He has no pleasure in the death of the wicked, Ezekiel 18:23 and verse 32. It's God's desire that all men be saved, Paul said in 1 Timothy 2:4, he's not willing that anyone should perish. Well, if that's his desire, if that's his will, why would he create a world where people will be lost, contrary to his will? Well, it's because God made us to love us and for us to love him in return. Not because he needs it, not for his fulfillment, but for ours. But love is not meaningful unless it is chosen. And so because God is love, the irony here is people think, well, how can hell be compatible with the love of God? But it's because God is love, he allows us to choose to either freely love him or reject him. And so that allows the possibility of rejecting God. So as we sometimes point out, and I think this is a valid emphasis to make, it's not really so much that God is sending us to hell if we die lost, but we are sending ourselves there. It's a choice that we make. Now again, if I can cite C.S. Lewis, you've heard me cite this before. Lewis said, heaven is when we say to God, not my will, but thine be done. But hell is when God says to us, not my will, but thine be done. He gives us the opportunity to submit to his will. And if we refuse, if we're insistent on our own selfish will, then he grants that. Because he is love, he grants that. And so we have to understand, it's our choosing. The choice is ours, that your fate is in your own hands. See, this makes this very serious, very sobering, when we realize our eternal destiny is in our hands. So as we think of what the whole gospel is all about, these concerns about how can hell be compatible with the justice of God? How can it be compatible with the love of God? See, the answer the gospel gives to that is the cross of Jesus Christ. The cross is where God's love and justice meet to make possible our deliverance from hell. You know, the question we ought to be asking is, how can a just God send anyone to heaven? If he's just, how can he treat me like I haven't sinned? Because Jesus bore my sin in my place because of God's love. And so the cross, just as hell should show me the magnitude of my sin, the cross should show me the magnitude of my sin as well. What Jesus had to suffer to pay the price in my place. But it should show me the love of God, that he was willing to pay that price in giving his son. And that love draws us to God. But so does the fear of God. If you think of the love of God drawing you, the fear of God impels. Sometimes people say, well, we're not going to preach that crude medieval Christian doctrine in our modern world. We don't want to scare people into obeying the gospel. We don't want people responding because they're afraid of going to hell. Well, that shouldn't be the only factor. But Jesus wanted to scare us when he talked about hell, Matthew 10:28. Fear him who can destroy soul and body in hell. You need to let the fear of hell drive you to Christ, even as the love of Christ draws you to him. It's not one or the other. It should be both. But you are stronger in the sense that you can resist it and you can refuse it. So we urge you not to do that. Your fate is in your hands. If we can help you to respond to the gospel and be put right with God and be delivered from the wrath to come, have the hope of eternal glory, let us know. Let's stand and sing together.